Hello everyone. Up to this point, we have focused on accounting for service companies, but we haven't defined clearly what a service company is. Simply put, a service company sells services. They offer you their time, their skills, their expertise, not actual physical products. In this session, we will shift our focus to merchandising companies. Unlike service companies, merchandising companies sells actual goods, like supermarkets, Walmart, Costco. Why is it important to differentiate between these two types of companies? The reason is simple. Certain accounts and transactions that exist in service companies may not exist for operation companies and vice versa, due to the nature of their business. In this session, we will first explore the key differences between a service company and a merchandising company from an accounting perspective. We will focus specifically on inventory-related accounts such as purchases, purchase returns and allowances, and logistics involved in selling and buying inventory. We will also dive into the transportation cost and the related terms such as FOB shipping, FOB destination. At the end, we will explore how to account for merchandising company from a basic perspective, including defining the operating cycle, comparing the periodic and the perpetual inventory system. This is an introductory session for merchandising operation. This session will be followed by several other videos, several other lessons dealing with accounting for merchandising companies. At the end of the session, we'll work a multiple choice questions. Let's go ahead and get started. Before we proceed any further, I have a public announcement about my company, FarhatLectures.com. Our financial accounting course is best for online students and students who are struggling in their financial accounting courses. We cover all the essentials from debits and credits, adjusting entries, closing entries, financial statements, and all balance sheet accounts. Our comprehensive course include lectures, multiple choice, true, false, as well as practical exercises. Start your free trial today to help you pass your financial accounting course. Your success starts here. Let's start by differentiating between merchandising companies and service companies. Merchandising companies are businesses that buy and sell product to generate revenues. What does that mean? Think about this individual. This individual is a merchandiser. This individual first buy the tomatoes from the farmers or from the suppliers. Then they sell those tomatoes to customers. Now, they might do minor modification. They might package them differently than how the farmer sold it to them. But minor modification, they don't change the tomato. They don't make, tomato sauce or anything like this. So they buy product A and they sell product A plus a profit. That's their goal. Example would include, merchandisers would include sporting goods stores like Dick's Sporting Goods, clothing stores, auto parts stores. All these companies are considered merchandisers. Why? Because they buy the product, then they turn around and they sell it with minor modification for a profit. Versus a service organization. A service organization, think about this individual who is, let's say, plumber, sell their time or expertise to earn revenue. How do they generate the revenue? They go to your house, they fix your toilet, they fix your car. If we're talking about a mechanic, they sell their time, their expertise. Examples include accounting firms, law firm, plumbing services, doctors, lawyers. That's what they do. They sell their time and expertise. An accounting firm like FinServe earns revenue by providing accounting services, not selling a product. Now, in the real world, not all companies are 100% either merchandising or service companies. Some merchandising companies might have minor service. Some service companies might sell some product. And bear in mind, we also have manufacturing companies. Manufacturing companies, they buy product A, they buy B, C, then they hire labor, then they sell you X, Y, Z. They sell you something else. That's manufacturers. And you'd learn about this in your managerial accounting course. Let's talk about the income statement for merchandisers. For merchandisers, their income statement would look slightly different than a service company.
Merchandisers will start with net sales. For the purpose of this company, 145,000. Don't worry, we're going to define net later on. Just let's say sales. Sales is the revenue from selling minus returns, allowances, and discount. The minuses, we'll discuss them later. Then we will deduct from sales something called cost of goods sold. What is this account? This is a new account. It's an expense. What is this expense? If you're a merchandiser, if we go back to selling tomatoes, before we buy the tomatoes, let's assume we buy each pound for a dollar. So when we buy each pound for a dollar, let's assume we bought 10 pounds or 100 pounds. We bought 100 pounds, we paid $100. When we paid the $100, that $100 is inventory. So first, before you sell something, you have to buy it. So what we paid is $100. Now we're going to turn around and sell those 100 pounds at 250 per pound. When we sell them, they will be sold at $250. So from a sales perspective, we sold them for $250. Our cost for those tomatoes are $100. Our gross profit is $150. So cost of goods sold represent the direct cost attributed to the goods sold for that period. For here, for our example, for our simple example, we purchased 100 pounds of tomatoes and we sold them for $250. The difference between sales and cost of goods sold, called gross profit. This number indicates the profit earned from selling goods before deducting operating expenses. What are operating expenses? For a business to survive, we need to pay salaries, rent, utilities, taxes, insurance, other costs related to running the business. So merchandisers will have two costs. They will have the cost of the goods. The cost of the goods, it means the cost of the goods that they are selling. For our purpose, we sold tomatoes and we paid for them $100. Then they have other expenses operating the business. To operate the business, you have to pay for employees, you have to pay for utilities, you have to pay taxes, insurance, so on and so forth. So net income is the final profit after expenses have been deducted from gross profit. Remember, we have two type of expenses, cost of goods sold and operating expenses. Now for merchandisers, there's something called the operating cycle for a merchandiser. This is the process, the time it takes from purchasing inventory to selling the inventory to collecting the cash. Well, how does it work? First, we have a purchase. We make a purchase. We take some money and we invest this money in inventory. Then what we do, we try to sell this inventory. What we're going to do, we're going to advertise. We're going to place it in our store. Then we are going to sell. Sometime when we sell on credit. We sell and what we do, we tell the customer to pay us later. Then we create an account receivable. Then we collect the cash. So from the time we make the purchase till the time we collect the money. So let's assume we might start with $10,000. Then we might end up with $18,000. What is this process? How long does it take from the time you purchase until the time you sell? There's a length, there's a cycle length, completing the length of the cycle, cash to cash. Now, how long is that cycle? It all depends on the industry. It all depends on the business. For example, a department store might have a cycle from 2 to 5 months. A grocery store will have a shorter cycle, 2 to 8 weeks or 2 to 8 days, depending on what the grocery store sells, because they want to buy, sell and receive the money real quick, because grocery store, they cannot have the grocery sitting in their store for a long period of time. Well, we cannot compare the cycle length from a grocery company to a retail company, to a department store. Why? Because in the department store, the clothes might sit on the shelves for several months and nothing will happen. Grocery, we can't do that. Also, we cannot compare grocery to department store to software company or to a company that manufactures communication equipment. Totally different. Now, generally speaking, shorter cycles offer advantages because they improve cash flow by reducing the amount of money tied up in inventory and receivable. True. But when you need to sell your product quickly, you might have to reduce the price. And when you reduce the price, you might have to reduce your gross profit. Because if you want to sell something quickly, how do you sell it? You reduce the price. If you reduce the price, you cannot reduce your cost. Your cost stays the same. Whatever you paid for something, if you have to sell it for less, it's going to eat up your profit. So it's very important to understand, yes, the advantage of is getting your money fast, but at the same time, you might earn a lower profit. We need to be familiar with two inventory systems, perpetual inventory system and periodic. We will focus on perpetual throughout the lessons and we'll have one session for periodic. What is the difference between perpetual inventory system and a periodic inventory system? It all deals with how do you keep track of your inventory. Under a perpetual inventory system, you continuously update your accounting record for each purchase and each sale. What does that mean? It means when you purchase inventory, you bring your inventory up. When you sell your inventory, you bring your inventory down. Advantage is your inventory is real time. It offers real time data on inventory levels and cost of goods sold, enabling management to make more informed decision. I still remember the story. I always tell it in the classroom. Is one time I was at Kohl's and we wanted to buy a toaster. And we did not find the toaster physically in the store. Then as we were walking in the store, we ran into an employee and we asked them, do you have this toaster? So they immediately pulled, you know, a small tablet from their pocket. They input the number and they told us, yes, we have the toaster. You know, it took them a few minutes to physically find it. Nevertheless, they were able to find out that they had one toaster left. Why? Because they have a perpetual inventory system. They know exactly how many units they have. Periodic inventory system, you update your records at the end of the accounting period. The advantage of this is it's easier and less expensive to maintain, though it provides less timely information. So in a periodic inventory system, the word periodic means on a regular basis, periodically you count your inventory. So this is an old system, periodic system. Now with technological advances, with AI these days, with technology, with scanners, with RFIs, what's going to happen? It made perpetual system more common and cheaper to implement, and it gives you a better decision making. Now, when a company make a purchase, they receive an invoice. What would the invoice looks like? This is tech gear, bill to, or when you sell an item, also you have an invoice. John retailers, the invoice date, invoice number, the due date, payment terms. So the invoice date is the date of the invoice. The invoice number, it's a unique number, and you will need those numbers later on when you're doing an audit. Due date is when do you have to make the payment. So the invoice date, your invoice 715, you have to make the payment 814. Now the payment terms net 30. It means you have 30 days, and they're not offering you a discount. Now we're going to talk about a discount shortly. On the invoice, you will see a description of what you are buying. A subtotal, the seller is offering a discount up front, then there's taxes of 8%, then there's the total amount due, then there's the payment instruction. Basically, this is what an invoice would look like. Now, what's important about the invoice is the shipping terms and the discount. We're going to talk about the discount first, and we'll talk about the shipping. It's important. Here, we're not specifying who's paying for the shipment, but we have to understand this. But this is what an invoice typically would look like. Starting with the discount, purchases and cash discount. Cash discounts are incentives to pay early. For example, here, if you remember from this invoice, it was we were invoice 715 and we have to make the payment August 14th, which is 30 days later. Now the customer might tell us, look, if you pay within a period, a certain period, if you pay within the discount period, let's assume 10 days, we're going to give you 2% off. So terms like 2/10 and 30 means you got 2% if you pay within 10 days. So you have a total credit period. You have 30 days. This is the credit period. This is the credit period, 30 days. However, if you pay within 10 days, we'll give you 2% of the bill. This is how you read those discounts. So why would a buyer grant a discount? Because they want you to pay early. Why do they want you to pay early? Because they are in need of the cash. The seller wants you to purchase from them, but at the same time, they want you to pay them early. So what they do, they say you have 30 days. Well, since they're giving you a credit time, you will make the purchase. Then what they do, they add to that an incentive, an enticement for you to pay early, and that's the discount. Now, from an accounting perspective, we need to know how do we record the discount under both the perpetual inventory system and the periodic, because the way we treat the discount is different. As I mentioned, in this session, we will use the perpetual inventory system, not periodic. We would look at the periodic in a separate recording. So let's take a look at this example. On November 2nd, Tech Gear purchased 600 worth of merchandise on credit with terms 2/10 and 30. We debit merchandise inventory $600. We credit accounts payable $600. We have more inventory at $600 and we owe $600. If we pay this bill by November 12th, which is 10 days from the date of the purchase, we only have to pay $588. Why? Because $600, we only have to pay 98% of it, which is $588. Or another way to say it, of the $600, we're getting 2% off. 2% times 600 is $12. So if the bill is 600 minus 12, we have to pay $588. So if we do pay within the discount period, we are going to debit accounts payable $600. Well, why? Because we owe $600, we're going to pay off the payable, our balance is zero. We credit cash $588. Hold on a second, this entry does not balance. We're missing $12. What do we credit for this $12? Remember, when we initially made the purchase, we debited merchandise inventory $600. This account here was debited $600. It means our cost was $600. Since we got the discount, we reduced merchandise inventory. We credit merchandise inventory by 12. Our cost of the inventory is $588. So the discount is credited to merchandise inventory. The discount reduces the cost of the inventory. Now, obviously, if we paid after November the 12th, we would have debited accounts payable $600 and we would have credited cash $600 because we have no discount. Now, we have to deal with purchases with returns and allowances. Sometime we make a purchase, we don't like the product, what do? We will return it. So what is a purchase return? Well, goods returned by the buyer to the seller. That's as simple as that. What is a purchase allowance? Why would you return something you don't like it? It's the wrong color, the wrong size. Well, purchase allowance is different. It's a price reduction for defective or unacceptable goods. So what is a purchase allowance? Well, let's assume you purchase something online, you receive the product, and the product was damaged. What do? You call the seller, you'd say, look, I received the product, it's damaged, or it's the wrong color, the wrong size, this is not exactly what I ordered. The seller might say, you know, you purchase $1,000 worth of merchandise from me, you owe me $1,000. If you keep it, you only have to pay me $900. What does that mean? It means I'm going to reduce your bill by $100. This is a purchase allowance. You keep the product and you pay less. You get an allowance. Purchase return, it's totally different. You return the item. Now, an example would be something like this. On November 5th, Tech Gear, the purchaser, issue $40 debit memorandum. What is a debit memorandum? A debit memorandum, also known as a debit memo, is a document issued by the buyer to inform the seller of a debit made to the seller accounts in the buyer's record. Simply put, when the buyer gets a purchase allowance, they issue a debit memo to tell the buyer we are reducing our accounts payable. So if you purchase something and you got a debit memo, you received a purchase allowance, you issue a debit memo, let's assume it's for $40, they gave you a $40 credit, the seller gave you a $40 credit, you will debit accounts payable, $40. You reduce accounts payable and you reduce your inventory because your inventory cost you $40 less. Now, the same entry would apply if this was a purchase return. If you'd returned $40 worth of merchandise, same thing. You will reduce your accounts payable. You would reduce the cost of your inventory because you actually returned $40 worth of inventory. So a purchase return and a purchase allowance, the journal entry is the same. That's not going to be the case when we do a sales return and a sales allowance. Wait until we sell the product. All what we're doing here is we're looking from the purchaser, from the buyer's end. Now remember, the buyers and a retailer becomes a seller, and we would look at the seller side in the next recording. Let's take a look at this comprehensive example to kind of bring everything together. Tech Gear purchases 500 worth of merchandise on July 1st, 2/10 and 60. 2% within 10 days, you pay the full amount in 60 days. On July 3rd, Tech Gear returns $100 of goods before paying the invoice. When Tech Gear pays on July 10th, they were able to take the 2% off because they paid within 10 days from July 1st. So let's take a look at the journal entries. July 1st, pretty straightforward. Debit merchandise inventory, credit accounts payable. We have more inventory and we owe $500. On July 3rd, we made a return. We returned $100 worth of merchandise. It's the opposite of a purchase. We debit the payable and we credit the merchandise inventory. Now, on July 10th, we paid the bill and we took 2% off. Here's a common mistake that students make. When you pay the bill on July 10th, you're going to get 2% off the $400, not the $500. So remember, you take the discount based on the remaining balance. So when you pay off the bill, you have to pay $392, which is 400 times 0.98. You pay 98% of the bill. You pay 392 in cash. You remove your remaining accounts payable of 100 and you credit the merchandise inventory. You reduce your merchandise inventory by the difference, $8. This is one of the common mistakes that students make, that what they do is they take the discount, they take 500 times 2%, they're going to say, well, we have a discount of $10, they assume they have to pay $390, the discount is $10, this is incorrect. Just be careful if you make a return or if you get an allowance to adjust your accounts payable for that. Because from an accounts payable perspective, yes, you started with 500, but you return 100, what's left is 400. So the discount is subject to the 400 remaining balance. Another topic you need to be familiar with, I said it will be on the invoice, is the transportation terms or the transportation cost. It determines who pays for the shipping and who bears the risk of loss during transit. This is important, especially in the real world. In the real world, you might buy something from China, Europe, from the other side of the country, from California, from New York, from Texas. So the question is, when these items are in transit, whose item is it? Well, who bears the risk of the loss? Well, it all depends on something called the shipping terms. It could be FOB, free on board. Don't worry about what does that mean. FOB shipping, which where the buyer pays for the shipping cost and owns the good. So let's assume the buyer either hires someone or the buyer hires someone or they drive their own trucks. So if the buyer drives to the place of business and pick up the inventory and they drove back, anything happened to that truck on the way back, it's the property of the buyer because the buyer is taking the risk of the loss. The buyer don't have to be there. The buyer can hire UPS, can hire a shipping company, can hire a third party. But if they're paying for the shipment, the inventory becomes their risk and their reward and their loss. The risk of loss is with them. If the shipping terms are FOB destination, here the seller is using their vehicle, and here again, they don't have to use their vehicle. They can pay for the shipment. They can hire someone. Notice they are shipping it to you. The seller pay for the shipping cost. Therefore, if something happened on the way to the buyer, this car get into an accident and this is destroyed, it's the seller's loss. Why? Because it's FOB destination. The seller is responsible for the goods until they receive, until they arrive to the buyer. And there's a lot of complication to this, not complication, consequences, because when we count inventory, which we're going to do in the next few session, we have to take into account goods in transit. Well, if it's goods in transit, it's on that truck, it's in between the buyer and the seller, whose inventory is it? Well, it all depends on whether it's FOB shipping or FOB destination. So, Tech Gear purchases merchandise with FOB shipping point. Well, if they pay $80, what's going to happen is this. FOB shipping point means you purchase, let's assume you purchase $1,000 worth of inventory, and if you paid $80 in transportation, you have to add the $80 to the $1,000. Therefore, you have $1,080 of inventory. Therefore, you add the $80, you debit merchandise inventory, and you credit, since you paid cash, you credit cash. So, FOB shipping, okay, means the buyer is paying. It means that transportation cost gets added, gets tacked to the inventory. And I hope this is a common sense concept, because let's assume you paid something, you purchased something online for $100, then you pay shipping $10. Well, how much did it cost you? It cost you $110. So the $10 is added to the cost. So the $10 is an asset. Why? Because it's added to the asset. It's added to the inventory. Let's determine the cost of our purchases. When we purchase something, we have to account for that as inventory. So simply put, when we debit the inventory account, how much do we debit the inventory account for? One thing is the purchase price. Let's assume we purchase something for $1,000. If we received any sort of a discount, let's assume we received a discount for $10, we reduce it by the discount. We returned from that purchase $40 worth of merchandise. The customer gave us, the seller gave us an allowance for $100. Okay? Then we paid the transportation cost of $20. How much did that item cost us? Well, we started with $1,000. We reduced it by $150. We're down to $850. Then we paid transportation of $20. The cost is $870. So make sure you know this formula. This is the cost of the merchandise. So the merchandise would end up to be $870. This is the purchases. So Tech Gear recorded purchases. We debit the purchase. We debit the purchase for the inventory. Discount, return, and allowances are credited. We credit those. And the transportation is debited. So from a T account perspective, when we make a purchase, we debit the account, discount, allowance, and return are a debit, and transportation in is a debit. We're going to have transportation in. Eventually, we're going to look at transportation out, which is totally different. We'll talk about that later. So transportation in is an asset. Let's take a look at this multiple choice question from farhatlectures.com. Which of the following best describe the term FOB shipping point? FOB shipping point. What does it mean, FOB shipping point? Simply put, it means that the buyer is paying for the merchandise. It means the buyer bears the risk. The buyer owns the goods once they are shipped and pays for the shipping cost. Yes, that's a good definition. The seller owns the good until they arrive. No, if it's FOB shipping, well, the buyer is paying for the shipment. The buyer is responsible. The seller don't owns the good. The buyer owns the good upon arrival. No, they own the good as soon as they put that goods in the truck or in the common carrier, plane, ship, whatever the carrier is. The seller owns the good once they are shipped and pays for the shipping cost. No, the seller don't pay for the shipping cost. FOB destination, FOB shipping point, the buyer pays for it. FOB destination, the seller pays for it. So FOB shipping point, the buyer owns the good once they are shipped and pays for the shipping cost. Make sure to know the difference between FOB shipping, FOB destination. One of the basic terms you need to be familiar with. What should you do now? You want to go to farhatlectures.com, look at additional lectures, resources, It's going to help you whether you are a financial accounting student, CPA exam candidate, CMA exam candidate, taking this for professional development. Invest in yourself. Good luck, study hard, and of course, stay safe.